Let me tell you about xenon poisoning. You might say, poisoning? Wait, xenon is a noble gas. Those things are non-reactive. This isn't the kind of poison that would kill you. It's the kind of poison that stops a nuclear reactor. Let's remember what a reactor is trying to do. It's a giant neutron dance. Right? You've got the uranium, which splits, and it gives off extra neutrons. 2.45 on average, maybe 3 in this particular example. These neutrons eventually hit things called the moderator, water, typically, and it slows down on the nuclei that are the same size, the hydrogen nuclei. So the neutron will bounce around, hits the water, slows, slows, slows. If it goes slow enough, its cross-section, its chance of making another fission, gets larger, so it will eventually hit another uranium, it fissions, and off come more neutrons. Now you might notice it just took one neutron to make a second fission. If this were a bomb, this indeed increases exponentially. The uranium is at such a high concentration that it packed so close together, you don't even need a moderator in those cases. The neutrons, even with the chance of making a fast fission, which is small, but there's so much neutrons, so many uranium atoms packed close together, that most of the neutrons in a bomb make more fissions. Those fissions add up extremely quickly, and you have that tremendous release of energy. In a nuclear reactor, it's a controlled chain reaction for a couple of reasons. First, some of the neutrons just leak out of the reactor. Others get hit by something called a control rod. Right? These control rods actually absorb the neutron, and it stops. By balancing the amount of the control rod, how far you push it into the reactor, for instance, or by controlling the geometry of how many of these neutrons just leak out, and even by the presence of a moderator, because after all, if you don't have a moderator, you won't have the chain reaction at all because you'll never slow them down. Reactors have very low concentrations of the fissile fuel. So this neutron dance is controlled to give you a steady, steady, steady amount of fissions. You want a little more power? Pull the control rod out a little bit. Less power? Put the control rod in further, slowing down, removing some of the neutrons. Where does xenon come in? Well, xenon 135, right here, this molecule, right? The element xenon, a particular isotope, is really good at absorbing the neutrons. It becomes a control rod, in effect. It absorbs the neutrons. If the xenon 135 amount in the reactor builds up, the reactivity of the reactor, the chance of the reactor being able to keep going on its chain reactions, dramatically decreases. You might say, oh, that's great. It's a neutron poison, right? It absorbs the neutrons. It stops the chain reaction. What could possibly be wrong with that? Not understanding it is what can possibly be wrong with that. So let's just review for a moment what the physics is about xenon 135 and where it comes from. So that xenon 135 is a poison. It absorbs neutrons. Actually, it absorbs it 4,000 times more than uranium absorbs neutrons. Where does it come from? When uranium-235, right, is hit by that neutron, it breaks up into fission products, fission product one, fission product two, right? And of course, some of those extra neutrons. Sometimes, rarely, one of these fission products is actually xenon 135. But that's pretty rare. Maybe only 0.3% of the time do you make xenon 135 directly, much less than 1%. And that alone would not really be that much of an issue. But the thing is that 6.3% of the time you make iodine 135. It's a fairly common fission product. And iodine 135, unlike xenon 135, is radioactive. And remember, radioactivity means it turns into something else. Iodine 135 goes to xenon 135 and a beta. And of course, also an antineutrino. We don't have to worry about the neutrinos. This beta decay creates xenon. And the half-life of iodine 135 is 6.6 hours. So you're constantly in a reactor making iodine 135. Every time there's a fission, you create iodine 135. 6.5 hours later, half of that iodine has turned into xenon 135. And you might say, oh my God, that's going to build up. That's going to build up. You're right. So how does a reactor possible? If that xenon 135, this neutron poison, 4,000 times more absorbent of neutrons, like really good paper towel, if this is such a great neutron absorber, and 6.6% of the time I'm making something that will lead to it, what happens? 6.3% of the time we're making iodine 135. And then we wait 6.6 hours and it turns, half of it by that point will have turned to xenon, the neutron poison. And the neutron poison itself, xenon 135, it just stays there. Clearly nuclear reactors work. So there's got to be something that gets rid of xenon 135. And there is. Turns out that xenon 135 itself is also radioactive. It goes to cesium 135 through beta decay, right? And this half-life is 9.1 hours. Longer than this. So you can say, aha, I'll make the xenon, but it takes even longer for it to go away. Because this half-life is longer than this half-life, it still would make a nuclear reactor very, very difficult to operate. Probably have to have a much higher fuel concentration. So if we just had this, we just had xenon 135 decaying and being caused by something that's a little faster, yes, it would eventually go away. But that's not the main way you get rid of xenon 135. You see, xenon 135 can simply be hit by that neutron. Remember this neutron that it's absorbing? And this becomes xenon 136. And xenon 136 does not absorb more neutrons, and also it's stable. This turns out to be the main way you get rid of the poison. And since there are lots and lots and lots of neutrons in a nuclear reactor, as long as the reactor is operating, so that we have the neutron dance going on, we have the fissions going on, the xenon 135 level is kept to a small amount. That's the important point here. Let me draw a graph, right? And this will be a graph of the xenon 135 concentration. And this is time. So here, right at the very beginning, we turn on the nuclear reactor. There's no xenon 135 in the reactor at all. No fission products have taken place. No fissions are going on. But we pull out the control rods, One random fission occurs, starts the chain reaction, and slowly over time the xenon starts building up. But it's also being destroyed by this copious neutron flux. So it reaches some steady state, maybe about 50 hours. But that's fine, this could just keep going. We're now at a level point, and that's how you normally operate your reactor. But at some point, you're going along and you decide, hey, you know what? Let's turn off the reactor. Let's put in all the control rods. Go home, right? Don't need the electricity. Refuel, whatever reason you want to shut down the reactor. So let's just think about what happens. We've been making fission products, these things, right? There's a whole long list, but I'm only concentrating on those two. We've been making iodine. Iodine is sitting there. 6.3% of the fission products are iodine-135. Now the iodine, over time, starts decaying, starts turning into xenon. And yes, the xenon decays itself, but this was our main reaction that got rid of it, and this reaction is now no longer happening because there's no neutron flux. So the xenon-135 concentration starts going way up. And eventually, because it will decay and all of the iodine will be gone, it will eventually come back down. You can see, however, that until about, 60 hours or so, maybe 3 days, you won't get this xenon level back down to where it was in the steady state. And we drill this into every nuclear engineer we teach. If you ever turn off the reactor, you've got to wait 3 days to turn it on. You have to wait. Because if you don't wait 3 days to turn it on, you say, oh, I turned it off by mistake. Oh, I'm sorry, let me turn it back on. Your reactivity, your reactor is poisoned. And you'd have to take extraordinarily dumb measures to try to get the reactor to go back into some fission chain reaction. But that's exactly what they did at Chernobyl. They accidentally turned off the reactor. But they still wanted to do an experiment. And because they still wanted to do this experiment, they broke a cardinal rule of nuclear engineering. Once you turn off a reactor, you have to wait 3 days to turn it on. They waited a mere hour or two and tried to turn it on to disastrous effect. So what actually happened at Chernobyl? They clearly didn't know about xenon poisoning, or certainly didn't remember about it. And what they had to do was get the reactor to respond, because they wanted to turn it back on so they could do their experiment. So here's a graph that shows in the blue line the one I had just drawn for you, the xenon-135 concentration. And the orange line is something called reactivity. This is how easily you can maintain a chain reaction. And you notice normally you go along at steady state and we have a bit of a negative number here, which means you gotta do some work, gotta adjust the control rods. The reactor will eventually turn itself off if you don't do that. But with the xenon poison, you have a lot of excess negative reactivity. But if you wanna get the reactor operating, the only way to do that during this time frame is to take out the control rods. The control rods are your neutron absorbers. But here, you've got suddenly something really, really good at absorbing the neutrons. So what they did at Chernobyl, contrary to all of their regulations, all of their rules, is they started pulling control rods out. Control rods that were never even designed to be moved, because the normal reactor operation, you always would keep these in here. They removed reactor rod after reactor rod. Power still not coming up. Man, we have to do this experiment. We've got to get the power back up. Remove some more control rods. Oh, hey, a guy who was telling us what to do. By the way, that's a bad idea. Oh, shut up. I don't know what really happened in the control room, but they kept removing control rods. At some point, they tipped it over the edge. And instead of now being able to have a controlled nuclear reaction, they had an uncontrolled runaway nuclear reaction. That's why xenon poisoning matters. And that's what you need to know.